So the time has come to take a look at this mini disc player. Now, over the course of my making repair videos here on YouTube, a lot of people have criticized me for not really showing, you know, how I diagnose or exactly how I go about fixing something. And a lot of that is just simply because I don't have enough hands to be running the camera, and I frequently work solo, which is not always the best idea when you're working on electronic equipment. Now, I have talked in a previous video about diagnosing faults with electronic equipment. You know, the first thing to do is to confirm what does and does not work by actually getting the unit on your workbench. Now, this mini disc player came to me with a note on it saying that the display didn't work. Now, one of the first things that I like to try when I'm repairing something, I like to try the easy and obvious fixes first, because sometimes, you know, the things that have the biggest impact on operations, like a missing display or no power at all, have the simplest causes, like a blown fuse or a bad power cord or something along those lines, or even operator error. The next thing that I like to try, throw it in the back of my truck, let it ride around back there for a few days. You never know what the what vibration can do. You know, a little bit of vibration or something can sometimes jar something back into working. Sometimes it'll make it work long enough that you can diagnose the fault. Sometimes it fixes it forever. You sometimes get lucky. Back the first time, it's been more than 10 years ago since I went to the first public radio and television benefit sale. And my dad and I took the Cadillac there, and we bought a Pioneer 6-disc CD changer for $1. And they said, well, you know, it doesn't play. Just does not play, makes a horrible scratching noise. And at the time, it definitely did those things. Well, threw it in the back of the Cadillac, took it some 30 miles back home, and took it downstairs, plugged it into the stereo. Beautiful music. No scratching, no other problems, and it's worked fine ever since. In fact, I've never even so much as popped the cover on it. So the first thing I'm going to do here is I'm going to confirm that, you know, the complaint is indeed valid and that it still exists. You can see the power light's turned green, so it thinks it's turned on, but there is no sign of life from that display whatsoever. So I'm probably going to have to go inside this thing, because it seems that the ride home in the back of my truck has not produced any change in its behavior. Now, it might be possible, and you have to do this with caution, but, you know, if you think something's being caused by bad soldering joints or something, I usually start out, you know, play the drums on the unit or something. But depending on what it is, you know, if this had a hard drive in it or something, that probably wouldn't be a very good idea. But in this case, I think it should be pretty safe. But it seems like no amount of wiggling or thumping or anything along those lines is going to fix it. So it's time to pop the cover and go inside. Now, I take no responsibility for the results of any repair that you attempt on your own equipment. You're doing this kind of thing at your own risk. And with battery-operated equipment and stuff like that, you know, battery-operated stuff is generally, though by no means totally, safe to work on, because things like battery-operated television sets and things that use large batteries capable of high amounts of current delivery, both of those things can really hurt and bite you. And, of course, anything that plugs into the AC power line, like this mini disc player, can also do things that could injure or even kill you. So the safest rule I can offer you, you know, you're doing this at your own risk. I'm not responsible for the results, good or bad, if you attempt to fix your own equipment. But two things I would tell you. If you're not sure, don't. And number two, electronics don't have feelings and thoughts. They don't understand that you were only curious and that you'd never touch one of those again. So if you're not sure, don't. And be careful around things as you go to make tests and stuff. Here's another important word about your safety. In equipment such as this mini disc player, or compact disc players, DVD players, Blu-ray players, whatever they might be, it's very important that you be aware of the hazards of laser light. Laser light is extremely concentrated, and in many cases is frequently near enough to the edges of the visible spectrum that you can't see it, and so you can damage your eyes by doodling patterns on your retina, and you won't even know it until much time has passed. So anytime you're working on a piece of equipment that contains a laser, do as much work as you can with the power disconnected, and also make sure that if there is any possibility that you could be exposed to laser light, that you take some precaution to block it out. You know, maybe cover the optical deck with a with an opaque piece of construction paper or something like that, just to assure that you don't damage your vision because you can't get a new set of eyeballs. Now that said, there's not a whole lot going on inside this mini disc player. Some kind of little battery there on the board. A little power supply section over here and the transformer. And this is all stuff that you want to stay well away from when it's plugged in, because AC voltage is available with essentially unlimited current, and it wouldn't take much of that to hurt you quite badly. I go over here, and here's this controller chip for the display, and here's the pins to which the display is connected to the circuit board with. I'm going to take a close look at those and see if any of them are cracked or anything like that. I can actually do this two ways. I could take a magnifying glass and carefully examine each one of those, or I could turn the power on and carefully press on this board and see if I can affect any change in the display's operation, like if it suddenly comes to life or anything. Alright, no amount of poking and prodding at the display produced any change in its operation. So now I've gone ahead and I've actually removed the front panel from the unit, and this is what I'm looking at. Over here is the control board, and over here is the display and the power button board, as well as the timer play and timer record switch. Now what I'm seeing here, I'm looking at these soldering joints very carefully on this display panel, and I can tell you already that a number of them are cracked. That one right there. There's one there. That one looks suspicious. There's not a whole lot of solder on these things to start with anyway, so obviously somebody was asleep at the Wave soldering machine at Sony Corporation that day. Also, there's this little wire bridge here that links the two boards together, and it looks to me like some of these soldering joints are questionable as well. They just don't seem to be really secure connections. And so my guess is that if I retouch these, my theory is that if I retouch all these solder joints, which certainly can't hurt, provided nothing has been damaged by the fact that these things have been making intermittent contact possibly since the time this thing was new, I may just get lucky and get this thing to work. If this doesn't pan out, I'm going to have to go a little bit deeper, but I'm definitely thinking that there is something to the bad soldering theory. So I'm going to go over all these joints with the soldering iron, reflow them, clean them up a little bit, maybe add a little solder to some of the ones that seem to be lacking, and then I'll put this thing back far enough together that I can test it out. So I'm just waiting for my soldering iron to warm up over there, which it should be ready in a minute or two here, and then I'll go ahead and start soldering these things. Now some of you have asked me about, you know, can you show yourself soldering? Well, again, I'm working solo here, so no, I really can't, and I don't really consider myself the person that you should be asking about how to solder stuff. If you want to learn how to solder, the best thing you can do is look up a tutorial online, the Science Electronics and Repair Facts site, FAQ, Frequently Asked Questions, would be a good place to start. And when you go from there, you know, the advice that was given to me, and I had a lot of trouble learning how to solder well, but one day I cracked it, you know, one day it just clicked, and I was there. And my skill set has continued to improve ever since. I still wouldn't say that I'm the world's greatest solderer, but I can do a passable job of it, and I've even done a little surface mount work. But the advice that I was given was to go and, you know, get some wire and some solder and, you know, just practice soldering those things together, and then you can get a hold of some junk circuit boards and practice soldering on them. And by the time you get done with that, you ought to have the technique down pat. So my soldering iron should be about ready right now, and I'm going to go ahead and reflow these joints on this display connection because some of them are very definitely cracked. I'm back, and here's what I found. And unfortunately, I don't think it's good news. I resoldered all of the solder joints going to the display panel, as well as the two that were linking the boards, because I found some that looked suspicious. And I was more than a little surprised when I put everything back together, powered this mini disc player back on, and things were no better than they were. There's still no display, there's no red lines across the display indicating that, you know, it's getting any kind of power at all. So I started to look up the information on this OKI display controller chip to see if I could get a data sheet for it, and I did. Downloaded the data sheet, took a look at it, and basically the way this works, there's two supply voltages. There's one low voltage for the chip's internal logic and registers to operate, And then there's a much higher voltage, a negative voltage, that is actually delivered to the display to illuminate characters. Well, I've got both of those voltages. I've got a 3.3 volt logic supply coming in on pin 64 that is dead on, and I have a negative 30 or so volt supply that is supposed to go on to the display panel to illuminate the characters as they're called for. The only things that I can't verify for sure, there's a serial data link from the main system controller that comes to this thing, and I don't have any way of determining, I don't have an oscilloscope or anything like that or a logic analyzer to see if there's any activity on that serial bus between the system controller and this display controller. So I can only assume that, you know, maybe that's working. I would think that if the system controller was not working properly, that this player would not operate normally in every other regard. There's also a clock input that is present on this display controller chip, and the clock is actually generated over here using one of these two crystal oscillators. I don't know which one it is. I haven't attempted to determine that. I would assume that if either one of these were not oscillating, or the voltage coming to these oscillators to make them oscillate was missing, that other functionality would be impacted, and again, that's just not the case here. Now, I had a multimeter that had a frequency counter built into it. I don't have one otherwise, but that multimeter has long since walked, and so I can't do anything there to determine if these oscillators are actually running. So basically, I have hit a wall here. I fear for the controller chip. It doesn't even get slightly warm in operation. It doesn't give any outward indication that it's doing anything. And I don't have any test equipment that'll allow me to go deeper. So for the time being, I think I'm going to shelve this mini disc player, probably experiment with the medium a little bit. And then maybe if I'm feeling adventurous and I can get a hold of or borrow somebody's frequency counter or something like that, I might take another look at this thing and see, you know, if the chip appears to be bad for sure or not. But at this time, I really don't think there's a whole lot of other options going on here, given that every other part of this thing seems to operate as intended. If this display chip is bad, I think that's going to be the end of the line for my attempts to repair it, because as you can clearly see, it's a surface soldered part, and I don't have any equipment that's appropriate for working on surface mount devices. So that's the story as it stands right now.